Welcome everybody to the this session on enhancing business agility using WSO2 products. This is kind of an end-to-end presentation when it, with related to the solutions architecture that you have to typically deal with when you are constructing solutions in order to meet your agile business requirements. So first of all, we will look into what agility in the context of businesses. So this is the Wikipedia definition of business agility, which means agility is the ability of an organization to rapidly adapt to the market and environmental changes in a productive and cost-effective way. This is kind of a very abstract version of this definition. So we will look into the details. So a typical business system is consist of these kind of characteristics or factors, such as external factors and internal factors. But when it comes to providing an agile business platform, there are factors that we can actually control, and there are other factors that we don't have any control on. So this actually describes about the factors that has the most that have the most impact on business agility. So basically, when we think about external factors such as the behavior of the markets and the competition that you have to face with, so these are the objectives or barriers that we try to overcome by providing an agile business platform. And if you think about the factors that we can have a control on, basically that's what we have highlighted in orange color, systems. Because if you think about changing organizational policies or changing the already established organizational culture or business capabilities, these are somewhat hard to do at once. You need some time to adjust these factors. But if you think about the technology and the systems that you are using in order to deliver your internal capabilities to any changing needs in the business market, basically you can make quick alterations over the systems or in the way that you are delivering your capabilities. So that is the main point that we are trying to address here today. So this journey can be started with APIs, because if you think of APIs, basically APIs are the main delivery mechanism of the capabilities that you're offering to your markets in a digitally transformed world. Because you might have all your companies or organizations might have all products already, but APIs open a new digital medium so that you could deliver your capabilities very quickly into the markets, and it's also the entry point to new markets. Which means once you figure out that there is a need for something in the market, you can use APIs in order to introduce this very quickly into the market, and it is the best place to start the conversation with your audiences, the customer bases, because when you quickly introduce any capabilities in the form of APIs, people start to use this, and continuously they can provide you with feedback in order to make improvements or any suggestions. So this is the best place to start the conversation, because in a typical software development process, if you think about the UX development and the backend kind of capability development, if you started with the UX development first, you get a lot of feedbacks from the actual users of the solution so that you could improve the rest of the solution accordingly. If you started with backend development, based on some hypothetical ideas, basically you will have a problem when you are exposing your capabilities into your intended market, because the features has not been developed according to the needs of the market. So this is the same scenario that we have applied here. And it is the best place to analyze usage patterns and observe demands. So if you expose your capabilities in the form of different APIs, you can basically observe what are the APIs that are being used mostly. And you can scale those APIs accordingly in order to address demands. And based on some usage patterns, you can even introduce new APIs or new capabilities into these markets. For example, in latest online banking apps, you probably have found the options such as splitting bills. So those are kind of patterns that many app developers have found based on the usage or utilization of payment APIs. So if you look into a banking app like Monzo, for example, it basically provides you with the capability of splitting the bill right away and send some kind of a link so that the rest of the people who participated in the lunch can make their payments. Just like that, based on analytics, you can keep improving your capabilities or APIs. And API is the best place to govern and control what you need to expose and how you are going to expose, such as enforcing security and other controls such as throttling. And it's the best way to figure out the improvements need, just like I mentioned earlier. And when you have to deal with changing organizational cultures, when you introduce new technological platforms, basically, API management system is the best place to start that with, because without changing your existing solutions, you can expose your existing solutions in the form of APIs, well-managed APIs into new markets. But with the time, you can introduce the new trends or new changes to your internal organization culture as well, because you don't need to change everything when you are trying to expose something using API management solutions. And this is how we should typically start with. In this diagram, you can see there is a, let's assume that now there is a demand for some particular functionality. First of all, we need to identify what we need to expose in the form of an API. But in this diagram, you can see the actual API is under construction. We don't have an actual service running at the backend. At that point, we are promoting our API to external app developers. But meanwhile, we are developing our actual API. They need something to play with, or they need to have some kind of a mock API endpoint so that they can keep developing their applications. So if the API management solution supports this kind of prototype APIs, you can basically define the API contract using something like OpenAPI 3 or Sagar. And sticking to the same format, you can expose some mock API endpoints to your app developers who represent the immediate market of your capabilities that you're exposing from the organizational point of view. While you are developing your actual API backend, the app developers can use the mock API endpoint and keep developing their applications. And then when your actual API becomes ready, you can expose this directly through the same API gateway. At that point, the external API developers or app developers don't have to change or make any alterations within their program code, because they have used the same API contract. Basically, the requests and responses are the same formats. From the organizational point of view, you just have to change some kind of a URL so that the traffic would be routed to the actual backend. But that's not the end, because there can be still application developers who test their APIs again, the APIs that you have exposed. If you expose your actual or production API backends to the external developers to try out their applications, you are making you are exposing your valuable resources to some false traffic, which doesn't essentially deliver any business value. For that, you can have a sandbox environment routed through the same production gateway based on the keys or the security tokens that developers are sending into the API gateway. The API gateway should be able to route this traffic into the sandbox environment, which probably would have less amount of resources, like less amount of VMs or instances. Basically, you are facilitating the external developers to send false information and try and test their applications against the API that you are exposing. And then, when you expose your any kind of an organizational capabilities or assets into a common network, basically you need to think about security, because you don't know who are the people accessing your internal capabilities or resources. Then, of course, you need the help of another component, such as an OAuth server. Authentication server, basically. It can be any security mechanism based on your preferences, but the API gateway basically have to be secured with some authentication mechanism. Then, of course, you can control who could access your capabilities or assets in your organization. So this is the second part. And having features is good. I mean, it's a good thing. But extensibility is something that you might require at this point, because as an organization, from the security point of view, API authentication is not the only thing that you have to deal with. You will have to deal with a lot of identity integration, such as provisioning users from other systems into your internal identity infrastructure, or otherwise facilitating your web portals with something like single sign-on. So for most of these requirements, you need to have some kind of an IAM solution, full IAM solution. If you have this kind of solution already, the API management system that you're using is supposed to fix these gaps, and it is supposed to be integrated with the existing identity and access management solution or the user directories that you might have. So that is another thing that needs to be considered when you are starting with API management in order to enter business agility. And then identity integration is not the only thing that you have to consider, because in a typical production environment, your APIs are not the only thing that you have to deal with. You will have to deal with a lot of application integrations, data integration, and other system integrations like message brokers or whatever. So you need to have some kind of a component that facilitates integration in general, even workflows, everything. For that, you need to back your API gateway with a fully capable integration layer. And then, of course, here what we have described is the common integration points that you might have to consider, such as services and API integration, application integration, which means like systems such as Salesforce, SAP, or Dynamics CRM, and data integration, which means if you have existing data sources that needs to be integrated directly with your APIs, or the data sources that you need to expose in the form of APIs, then of course your integration platform is supposed to handle this. And workflow integration, identity and security integration is what we already discussed. And another very important thing, stream integrations, because in modern application architectures, you can find a lot of reactive applications or streaming APIs related integrations. So this part is coming very crucial. It is also, stream processing is also involved in many layers. But here we are discussing about the stream integration in middleware solutions level. But if you have dealt with a lot of UI frameworks these days, even there you can see many cases where people try to deal with a lot of stream integrations. And this is how you inject intelligence into the solution that we constructed so far using these logical diagrams. So here you can see we are publishing API usage related information into the analytics component, which was introduced in this diagram. So based on the usage patterns or raw data about API usage, you can actually have your own metrics in order to analyze the market's trends, or in order to perform some kind of an audit over the responses and the requests that have been passed through the gateway. If we think about a typical deployment, it is not about installing just component. You basically will have to have everything in cluster. So this is a very typical deployment where we would install two instances of WSO2 API Manager, all profiles included in single JVMs, and two instances of Enterprise Integrator in order to handle integration-related work, such as data integration, application integration, or messaging channel integration. And WSO2 Identity Server also, there are two instances each. Because in a typical deployment, we install two instances in order to make it highly available, so that if one node goes down, there would be another node to take care of the load that it's supposed to receive. And with the stream processor also, there you can see there are two instances in this diagram. But it can be different depending on the organizational requirements. So here is another sample where you have API Manager all in one nodes in one cluster. So this cluster would handle all the API management related work when it comes to API lifecycle management or API marketplace, API security and throttling and controls like that. But we have separated API gateways into another cluster in this case because we assume now this particular solution is supposed to receive a higher load, where we might have to consider separating the gateway nodes into a different cluster so that the entire collection of resources could be used in order to handle the API traffic. And in the enterprise integration layer, you can see we have followed a segregated architecture because one EI cluster is processing files, which can be a long-running process, which would involve heavy data transformations. So you don't need to disturb the rest of the flows with this kind of heavy processing element. That is why we have separated normal services and data integrations into another cluster of enterprise integrated. And identity server remains the same in this picture also. And when it comes to the stream processor, in order to receive events continuously from API gateway and other components like enterprise integrator, we have separated the receivers of the stream processors into one cluster. And in order to facilitate the dashboards, we have placed just one instance. Because dashboards are something that are being observed by human beings. So if that node goes down, basically human can wait. Depending on your preferences, you can even have one instance in order to facilitate the solution with the required dashboards. And this is another kind of deployment, which would look exactly similar to the previous one. But here you can see there are two new components called API Manager Micro Gateway and WSO2 Micro ESP. So these are kind of different from the normal conventional WSO2 instances we have, because they follow or they complement the microservices architecture. For example, there can be situations where you need to isolate some of the APIs or some of the integration flows into different independent units based on many requirements. Let's say now there is one particular API which is kind of prone to receive malicious information or malicious payloads, or otherwise, there can be an API which needs a significant amount of scaling compared to the rest of the APIs. So in such cases, you can compile one API gateway or a collection of micro API gateways to represent a single API. Similarly, you can isolate one particular integration process also into a micro USB and deploy it as a micro integration unit. That's basically it when it comes to the solutions architecture part of this presentation. And the next session is related to integration and identity and access management. During that talk, you will see these highlighted components in action, which is presented by Sagara and Nandika. And after that, after the lunch, you will have another session which will describe about API management and stream processing that would describe basically about the capabilities delivered by these highlighted components of the solutions architecture diagram. And after that, you have a session related to installing these WSO2 solutions and taking updates and how to automate the deployment and the rest of the administration work related to WSO2 products. The next presentation will be presented by Nuan and Suho. After that, you will have another session, which would basically describe the DevOps flows and WSO2 Update Manager and continuous integration and continuous delivery kind of processes. And you will see how we can pragmatically use these techniques in order to automate and automate WSO2 deployments and administration work, and how to basically stick to the DevOps culture.